the penis, and perhaps the testicles, the phallus, the male principle. Across here, the female principle with the vagina. This is the female vagina. Here also is the female aspect, the female genitals. Just behind the male. Here we have the testicles, and there's the phallus. So, what are we dealing with here? Should I return to these sites at night, waiting to film dark occultists partaking in ritualistic sex acts, or is there another esoteric aspect reserved only for those with the right connections and or bloodlines? Are the general public in the know? Those whom pretty much know nothing of the occult, the majority of which think they've got the world pretty figured out. Are they even getting to first base by spotting these publicly displayed pussies and penises? Do I think I've got the world figured out? Hell no. Anyway, so generally, people aren't informed. They go through school. And then perhaps they attend a technical and further education institution, commonly known as TAFE. As we recall, according to Passio, the checkers represent lowly base consciousness, as they are found on the floor of a Masonic lodge. A person in base consciousness or duality consciousness does not understand one's spiritual nature and does not have unity within one's thoughts, emotions, and actions. If Passio's checkers interpretation is correct, personally I find it quite fitting that the checkers can be viewed atop the pillar-esque aspects of the Faculty of Education at Sydney University. Further, the checkers are surrounded by what is perhaps an example of the highly ubiquitous occultist symbol, the red male left brain fire triangle. The red fire triangle is often cleverly concealed. I see it all the time when I'm out and about. Here is an example used by an organisation situated at the University of New South Wales in Kensington. World Care.
Care. Care.
On the southernmost wing of the quadrangle at Sydney University, we find numerous interesting symbols. Some are inside and some are outside. Some are quite banal though, as they assist to occult symbols such as this, the light bearer. Now, whilst many religions are well known, there exists a network of occult organisations that are arguably more powerful than the publicly perceived main religions. Indeed, I believe that during this video presentation, you have been viewing many symbols from this legion of occultists. In your everyday activities, you may not even realise it. You may not have the real eyes to see these symbols and signs. Indeed, the more I learn, the more I see. Legion, the apparent Latin etymology of which is legio, from legere, meaning to gather or collect. In a similar fashion, religion undoubtedly is derived from the Latin term religio, which perhaps further traces to religare, meaning to bind, tie, or fasten, like the ligamenture binding a joint. It is interesting that re and ra are interchangeable in reference to the sun god Ra, whilst ligare means to bind. It seems logical to me that religion may actually just be re legion, simply sun and bind. Passio asserts that binding is a magical term descriptive of a class of spells intended to thwart or hold back the progress of an opposing force or practitioner. Perhaps this is why Christians learn gospels or God spells as an act that perhaps subconsciously holds them back, binding them. The public at large learns how to spell too. Have you ever said something and realized that you've actually said two things, making you reflect afterwards on the word choice and emotion that just came out? Darren Brown is someone whom exposes the flexibility of our perceptions as he manipulates a person's thoughts with various cues.
It's sort of related to that whole area. I mean, you can absolutely lock that into place, and you could definitely see that as red, couldn't you? That's red, yeah? I mean, as a colour, if you looked at that as a colour and you had to name what colour that was, what would you say?
I'd say it was red.
You said that was red. Cool. Mm-hmm. And be honest, you know, so we've got, so these colours are?
A blue, a green, red, black.
Excellent, okay. Did you say you had your car outside?
Yeah.
Can we just go and look at your car? Is that all right? Excellent. Can you follow us, guys? Where was it?
It's a Hyundai. It looks just like that black car right there.
Looks like the black car just here, did you say?
Yeah. That's my license plate number. Definitely my car.
Mm.
Now it's black, but that's my car.
That is your car, but it's the wrong car.
Right color.
That's right. I see what you mean. So is there a car here that is the right color?
There's a red Hummer over there, but
where's the red Hummer? Through there. Can we see that? Is that red Hummer just there?
That is my car, but it's who painted it black though?
Our best friend thinks her car is black.
When it's red.
Everybody can see it's red except for her.
Yeah, that's pretty odd.
Here is an interesting Bible translation pertaining to the word legion. Remember, we are dealing with a story and allegory. In the following scenario, Jesus comes across a man possessed by an evil spirit. From the New Living Translation, Mark 5:9, we read, "Then Jesus demanded, 'What is your name?' And he replied, 'My name is Legion, because there are many of us inside this man.'" Also from the Bible, in the Gospel of Luke 8:30, we can also read another verse pertaining to Legion. So I will read, "And Jesus asked him, saying, 'What is thy name?' And he said, 'Legion,' because many devils were entered into him." Indeed, the term legion may refer to the gathering of spirits or binding of spirits. In short, for numerous reasons, I don't need to be convinced of a quote, spirit world, unquote. These days, I have become more consciously aware of vibes from others. My consciousness is seemingly modulated, thereby affecting my mood, both up and down, just by the presence of others close by. I find myself wondering whether the fasci has anything to do with the notion of binding spirits. It does feature in the Anzac War Memorial in Hyde Park, Sydney. Anthropomorphized depictions of these spirits are perhaps present on the British Medical Association building on Macquarie Street, Sydney, and also about the quadrangle at Sydney University. This church perhaps favours more saintly spirits. The Vice-Chancellor's Garden is situated just off the Sydney University quadrangle. Within the Vice-Chancellor's Garden dwells the goddess Fortuna, bearing a cornucopia. Elsewhere within the garden dwells the god Mercury. Mercury is standing on the head of what I presume is Argus, whom within mythology Mercury killed on the orders of Zeus. Mercury is commonly known as the messenger god, although the root of Mercury's association as a messenger lies within his similarity and historical interchangeability with the messenger god Hermes. Mercury is derived from the Latin word merc, from where we also derive the word mercy. Reminding us of the pillar of mercy on the Kabbalah, this pillar is associated with the fire element. From merc, we also get merchandise, merchant, and commerce. Indeed, Mercury is also a god of trade. With this in mind, it was quite fitting that I found $12 in coins, well weathered, at the statue's base. Indeed, someone perhaps paid tribute to the merchant aspect of Mercury's mythology. And indeed, it tells me that passers-by don't take much notice of this statue. Passio views that the hypercube, from a dark occultist's perspective, represents in part a prison for the mind. The hypercube can be symbolized by an octagon. There are at least three octagons at Sydney University. Regarding any occult intent behind them, I'm unsure. There are two at the Catholic Residential College of Sancta Sophia, one being in the garden and one being part of the architectural structure. The university's main quadrangle also has an octagon in the centre. At this point, I would like to say something. Just because I am pointing out various symbols and so forth does not mean that I automatically think that they are necessarily nefarious or benevolent in nature. For example, America has been set up for the most part by people adherent to occult doctrine. If you look at the history, it is neither just good nor just bad. I trust viewers of my videos are researched and are aware of these things. Enjoy the sightseeing, folks. So, we've viewed Mercury just off the quadrangle in the Vice-Chancellor's Garden. Now, if we stand in the quadrangle and focus outwards, as if we are looking down a ley line, it is slightly curious that we see the McCure Hotel. It kind of resonates, if you will, with the sculpture in the Vice-Chancellor's Garden. Hey, it's a funny world. Anyway, the McCure Hotel overlooks the pyramidal structures at Railway Square, of which I discussed in the Occult Sydney series. If we pan across the beginning of George Street, we see the pyramidal feature on the old Marcus Clarke building, which is now a TAFE. So, the McCure Hotel pretty much lines up with the Sydney University quadrangle. Atop the McCure Hotel is a swimming pool. A reflection pool, perhaps. As we peer through the V-shaped feature, we see the clock tower of Central Station. Here are some aerial views of the sight lines. Now, make of this what you will. One thing I do know is that reading Mercury the Messenger God's newspaper offerings to the masses blindly will never put me in standing as someone in the know. Please click the link in the description box for the next part.